Hi everybody, welcome back. Let's finish up our discussion of measurements of variability. The last time we were together, we talked about computing the standard deviation based on sample data. And we discussed that without this correction right here, the sample standard deviation would underestimate the variability in a population. But with the correction, over the long run, the sample standard deviation is a good, unbiased estimate of population variability. Let's talk about a few other characteristics of the standard deviation. In general, the standard deviation is going to be the default measure of variability that we use. Just like the mean is the default measure of central tendency, the standard deviation will be our default measure of variability. So it makes sense that we're going to want to know a little bit more about it. Do you remember learning this fun fact right here? If we add, subtract, multiply or divide every single score in a data set by some constant value, the mean would change in exactly the same way. For example, if you multiply every single score in a data set by 2, the mean will increase by a multiple of 2. If we subtract 5 points from every single score, the mean will decrease by 5 points. That's true as well with the standard deviation, but only when it comes to multiplication and division. If we were to add or subtract a constant to and from every single score in a data set, the standard deviation would remain unchanged. And that's because there would be no change in the variability of the data. Let me show you this example below, and then you'll get to see exactly what I'm talking about. In this example, we start with a really small data set. These are our X values. This is our raw data. Let's just assume it represents quiz scores. So, of course, I can compute an average quiz score, and in this case, that average score equals 5. Let's assume I decide to add a constant to every student's score. I want to add 2 points to every student's score, so I do that right here. Just like we suspect, the new mean will increase by 2 points. So the mean goes from 5 to 7. But one thing you'll notice is that the standard deviation from the original data does not change after we add 2 points to every single score. The question is, why? The answer is really very simple. When I add or subtract a constant to and from every single score, the new scores that we compute still have the exact same amount of variability. And standard deviation is a measurement of variability. Let's look more closely at the data and you'll see exactly what I mean. Look at how much 6 differs from 8, because that's what variability is all about, right? How much the scores differ from one another. 6 differs from 8 by 2 points. After we add 2 points to each of those scores in this new data set, how much does 8 differ from 10? It still differs just by 2 points. How much does 8 differ from 0? These two scores differ by 8 points. What happens after we add 2 points to those scores? When we look at those new scores in the new data set, they still differ just by 8 points. In other words, the variability between the scores will not change after we add or subtract a constant to or from every single score. But now check this out. This column represents taking those quiz scores and multiplying them by 2. As we would expect, the sample mean would increase by a magnitude of 2. So you take 5, you multiply it by 2, you get a sample mean of 10. That makes sense. And now look at this as well. What happens to the standard deviation? It increases by a factor of 2. If we took the original standard deviation, 3.46, and multiplied by 2, we would get 6.93. Why is that the case? Well, when we multiply or divide every single score by some constant, the variability in the resulting data will change. Let's go back to that original data. How much does 6 differ from 8? These two scores, when we compare them, they only differ by 2 points. But once I take these values and I multiply them by 2, now how much do they differ? Now they differ by 4. Do you see that when we multiplied them by 2, the differences between them also increased by a factor of 2? So we're simply trying to understand these different measurements of variability inside and out. We're going to be using them all semester long, so it's important that we understand some of their characteristics. Later on this semester, we're going to be looking a lot at graphical representations of data. The numbers on this x-axis represent IQ scores. I've mentioned before that an average IQ score is 100, and that's because IQ tests are designed to have an average of 100 points. Well, remember, the mean doesn't give us enough information to really understand an entire distribution of data. Along with the measure of central tendency, we also want the measure of variability to go along with it. So in these graphical representations, not only do we show the mean, we usually also show the standard deviation. So in these graphical representations of data, not only do we show the mean right in the middle, but coming out from the middle, we usually label the standard deviation. In this case, sigma equals 16. On a typical IQ test, the mean is 100 and the standard deviation is 16 points. On average, IQ scores differ from 100 by about 16 points. And the way we show that variability is with a line sticking out from that midpoint of 100. The standard deviation actually tells us quite a bit about the variability within a normal distribution. We know a lot about the characteristics of that normal distribution. In fact, once we know a mean and a standard deviation for a distribution, we can get a sense of how common and how rare any individual score would be. And that's because of something that we call the empirical rule. According to the empirical rule, 68% of all scores fall within one standard deviation of the mean. That's more than two-thirds of all scores are going to fall within one standard deviation above the mean and below the mean. Again, let's look at IQ scores. If an average score is 100 and the standard deviation is 16, then the score that is one standard deviation above the mean would be a score of 116. And again, if the mean is 100 and the standard deviation is 16, then the score that would be one standard deviation below the mean would be a score of 84. And what I'm telling you is that according to the empirical rule, we know that about 68% of all scores fall between 84 and 116. So about 68% of the population has an IQ somewhere between 84 and 116. So do you see how it's actually going to be very helpful to count in standard deviation units? Let's take that a step further. 95% of all scores are within two standard deviations above and below the mean. So here I'm just going to add another 16 points to that 116. I'm now at the point that is two standard deviations above the mean. And now let's start at 84, which is one standard deviation below the mean, and subtract another 16 points. That would give us an IQ score of 68. Between two standard deviations below the mean and two standard deviations above the mean is 95% of all scores. So 95% of the population has an IQ between 68 and 132. And check out this fun fact related to the empirical rule. 99.7% of all scores, that's 997 scores out of 1,000, are within three standard deviations above the mean and below the mean. So if we started at 132, which was two standard deviations above the mean, and then added another 16 points, we would find an IQ score of 148. If we start at 68, which is two standard deviations below the mean, and then subtract another 16 points, we would be at an IQ score of 52. 99.7% of the population has an IQ between 52 and 148. So in other words, we can use that empirical rule to understand IQ scores that are very common and IQ scores that are very rare. An IQ score above 148 would be incredibly rare. An IQ score less than 52 would be incredibly rare. This empirical rule works for any normal distribution, regardless of what we're measuring, regardless of what the mean or the standard deviation might be. So in that respect, it's incredibly flexible, and we're going to find that it's incredibly useful. As we wrap up our discussion of variability, think of how much we've learned already in such a short period of time. This is some output from SPSS using the explore command to generate just some basic descriptive statistics. And almost everything that we see in this output, we've learned about. We've learned about means, we've learned about medians, variance, standard deviation, minimum values, maximum values, range, interquartile range. We've learned about almost everything in that output, and we're just a few weeks into class. So give yourself a pat on the back. We've done a lot of work so far. The next time we get together, we're going to learn even more. And in fact, we're going to learn a lot about that normal distribution. And we're going to use what we've learned today about the empirical rule to our advantage. Well, my friends, I'll see you in that next video. In the meantime, be safe.